And then shall he speak unto them in his wrath, and vex them in his sore displeasure. I will declare the decree. The Lord hath said unto me, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee. And thou shalt break them with a rod of iron, and thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Shall we pray? Father, we're so grateful that you have drawn us by your Holy Spirit to put our trust in Jesus Christ. And how true it is, we're so blessed since we've learned to trust in you. Lord, we pray that as we see the heathen raging and the people imagining a vain thing as they're seeking, Lord, to rebel against your authority, your word, we realize, Lord, it's only a matter of time until you deal with the rebellion of man and you establish your kingdom, and Jesus shall reign where'er the sun doth his successive journeys run. Now, Lord, teach us your ways. Open our hearts to the understanding of the scripture, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. As we journey through the Bible, we've come to Luke chapter 21. And in this 21st chapter of Luke, we have Jesus giving to his disciples signs of the times before the destruction of the temple, and the times before the establishing of the kingdom of God upon the earth. We read that Jesus was daily teaching in the temple these last few days before he was arrested, tried, and crucified. That during the day, he would be in the temple teaching. At night, he would go over to the Mount of Olives with his disciples, and then spend the evening on the Mount of Olives. Early in the morning, he would be back in the temple teaching. And early in the morning, many people were gathering to hear him teach. The rift between Jesus and the religious leaders was growing day by day. In the 20th chapter, we find them seeking causes to accuse him, trying to trap him in his speech, and looking for ways by which they could have an excuse to arrest him and to bring him to the Roman authorities that he might be condemned to death. Daily, while he was there in the temple teaching, on one of those days, the disciples began to remark concerning the huge stones that Herod had used in the building of the temple. According to Josephus, some of those stones weighed as much as 180 tons. In the western wall of Jerusalem today, you can see stones that are estimated to weigh somewhere around 160 tons, and so it seems like perhaps Josephus was not far off in his estimate of the weight of the stones of the temple. Humongous stones, unbelievably large stones. And as the disciples were remarking concerning those stones, Jesus, just sort of in a side type of remark, said, "There's coming a day when not one of these stones is going to be left standing upon another." When they got over to the Mount of Olives that evening, the disciples said, "Lord," thinking of that prophecy, "not one stone left standing on another, Lord, what will be the signs of this happening and of your coming and the end of the world?" Now, they, in their minds, sort of related the destruction of the temple with the end of the world. A building that large with stones that huge, they sort of figured it would take the end of the world type of cataclysm to ever fulfill the prophecy of Jesus, not one stone would be left standing on another. And so in their minds, the events of the destruction of the temple and the end of the world coincided. They thought of them as concurrent events. And so Jesus began to answer them, giving them signs that would deal with the destruction of the temple, but also signs that would indicate that the end of the world was close. Now, when we say the end of the world, we're using the Greek word aionios, translating into English so often, and it doesn't mean the end of the earth as we see it, as it is today. It doesn't mean that the earth is going to explode and be blown to pieces. There will definitely be great geographical changes that will take place. The earth will again be restored to an equalized type of climate over the whole earth. I would assume that the polar regions would be changed, and that you would not have the great ice masses on the north and south poles, that as the North Pole area was once a tropical area, shall probably be so again. But it means the end of the world system that is in rebellion against God. It will be the end of the world as a system that is seeking to rule and govern over man, the rule of man over man. This age of darkness is going to end, but it's going to be actually the beginning of a glorious new age, the kingdom of God, when Jesus shall establish God's kingdom here upon the earth. So in answering their question, you have two sets of predictions. One set that predicted the destruction of the temple, the other that predicted the destruction of the age of man ruling over man. So, in answer to their question, Jesus, first of all, began to say to them, don't be deceived. There are going to be false messiahs that will rise, and there will be all kinds of wars and rumors of wars. There will be this struggle between men for power, power over nations. There will be wars within the nations, civil wars. And of course, even today, we are seeing our world wracked with civil conflict as men are vying for power and for control. But Jesus said, the end is not yet. These are not a sign of the end times. But then going on, he said, for nations will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. This would indicate a confederacy of nations grouping together to war against another confederacy of nations, or what would be termed world war. And of course, we have seen a couple of world wars in this century. Along with these world wars, there was going to be earthquakes in diverse places. There was going to be famines and pestilences and great signs from heaven. Now, as I look at these predictions, I realize that today there are earthquakes in diverse places. There are famines. Millions of people are starving to death throughout the world today. There are pestilences. So many different viruses, strains of viruses, and of course, the latest major pestilence, that of the HIV virus. And so these signs, I do not believe, are what Jesus is referring to. I think what we are seeing today is a precursor. I think that it's going to get much worse. I believe that the signs that Jesus is referring to are the signs that are going to take place during the Great Tribulation. You think that we've had some severe earthquakes now, but the book of Revelation describes earthquakes that are much more severe. The book of Isaiah, in the prophecies of Isaiah, he talks about the whole world being shaken, islands being moved out of their places, mountains dissolving, and really tremendous earthquakes such as we have not seen. The book of Revelation talks about famines, where it'll take a bag of gold to buy a loaf of bread. And thus, as you get into the book of Revelation and the Great Tribulation period, you find that these events of pestilences, earthquakes, and famines and so forth will be tremendously accentuated. But that's on the earth. In heaven, there will be heavenly kind of cataclysmic events that are taking place. And so Jesus speaks about that which would be in heaven also. And so in verses 12 to 24, he gives to them the signs of his coming again and the end of this age. He talks about the destruction of Jerusalem in verses 20 through 24, but beginning with verse 25, he begins to talk about the signs of the end of the age. Now, in talking about the destruction of the temple and the destruction of Jerusalem, in verse 24, he ends that particular section by telling us that the nation of Israel would be led away captive into all of the nations, and Jerusalem would be trodden under the foot of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. That is, the world would be under the control of Gentile nations. Jerusalem would be trodden down by the foot of the Gentiles. Now, we do know that in 70 AD, Titus came in with the Roman troops. He set siege against Jerusalem, as Jesus predicted here. When you see Jerusalem surrounded by the troops, then flee and pray that your flight will not be in winter and so forth. And he told of the destruction that would take place of the temple under the Roman troops. And sure enough, in 70 AD, they dismantled the temple. Not one stone was left standing on another. The prophecy of Jesus was literally fulfilled. Not only that, the Jews were taken captive and dispersed throughout all the world. And from 70 AD until June the 7th, 1967, Jerusalem was trodden under the foot of the Gentiles. But in June of 1967, the Israeli troops again took control of the city of Jerusalem, having wrested it from the control of the Jordanians. And Jerusalem now is under the control of the nation of Israel, which would indicate to me that the times of the Gentiles has been fulfilled, that we are presently in a short transitional period between that end of the Gentile times till the establishing of the kingdom of God upon the earth. And Jesus makes reference here that the generation would not pass until all of these things were fulfilled. And so it would appear that we are in those days that Jesus was referring to in the talking of the end of the world powers and the domination of the Gentile world powers. Now, in turning to the signs in the heaven, the signs in the sun, the moon, the stars, Matthew, in recording the message of Jesus to his disciples, tells us that Jesus told them that the sun would be darkened, that the moon would not give its light, and the stars would fall from heaven, that there would be a bombardment of the earth of great meteors, or perhaps asteroids, and that, of course, severe damage that would be caused by collision with meteors or asteroids. In Arizona, near Winslow, Arizona, you can see that great crater that they call the meteorite crater, where a meteor that was so large that it did not dissolve in our atmosphere collided actually with the earth and sent dust into the sky that clouded the skies for years afterward, and of course left that huge crater there in at the Arizona desert. And that's only one of the craters around the world where meteors actually have collided with the earth, and we can see the tremendous force and power that is unleashed when that kind of a collision takes place. Our scientists today are on watch for asteroids that might be on a collision course with the earth. We know that there is an asteroid belt out there, the Vangelin belt, and we are passing every once in a while through these asteroids, and we are watching to see if we might be on a collision course. Last year in March was it, that we had sort of a near miss. And the problem is we didn't know it until after it happened. But they're trying to refine their methods of tracking these asteroids. We know that there are thousands of them out there. Jesus would seem to indicate that it's going to happen in a pretty intensive way. This is revealed through other prophets. The prophecy of Joel, chapter 2, he said, God says, I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth. There will be blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. So the sun darkened. Joel said the moon turned to blood. Signs in the heavens. Isaiah chapter 13, beginning with verse 6, he said, howl ye, for the day of the Lord is at hand, and it shall come as destruction from the Almighty. Therefore shall all hands be faint, every man's heart shall melt. Notice people fainting, their hearts melting. Jesus says here in Luke, men's hearts will fail them for the fear of the things that are coming upon the earth. They shall be afraid, Isaiah said. Pangs and sorrows will take hold of them, and they'll be in pain as a woman who is in travail. And they shall be amazed at one another. Their faces will be as flames. Behold, the day of the Lord is coming. It's cruel, both with wrath and fierce anger, to lay the land desolate, and he will destroy the sinners out of it. For the stars of heaven and the constellations thereof shall not give their light. The sun will be darkened in his going forth, and the moon shall not cause her light to shine. And I will punish the earth for their evil, and the wicked for their iniquity. And I will cause the arrogancy of the proud to cease, and I will lay low the haughtiness of the terrible. Therefore, I will shake the heavens, and the earth will be removed out of her place or out of its orbit, and the wrath of the Lord of hosts, and the day in the day of the wrath of the Lord of hosts, and in the day of his fierce anger. So these events are events that will take place in what is commonly called the Great Tribulation Period. That period of time when God judges the earth because of its rebellion. God has been patient. God has been long-suffering. God has put up with an awful lot of abuse. But the day is coming when God is going to take his vengeance. He said, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay." The book of Hebrews said it's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God. It is to come against, notice, the world for their evil and the wicked for their iniquity. John, in the book of Revelation, as he describes the events that take place when Jesus opens the seven sealed scroll, he said, "I beheld when he opened the sixth seal, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree is casting her untimely figs when she is shaken by the mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together. Every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains, the mighty men, every bondman, every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountains and rocks, 'Fall on us, hide us from the face of him that sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?'" The great tribulation period, when God unleashes the forces of nature, when there will be cataclysmic signs in the heavens, where here on the earth, as a result of these things, there will be famines and pestilences, tremendous earthquakes. And immediately after the tribulation of those days, Jesus said, they will see the sign of the Son of Man coming with clouds and with great glory. But Jesus speaks that on the earth there will be perplexity, there will be distress, rather, of nations with perplexity. That might be translated, there will be national problems with no answers. I'd like to suggest that we're already beginning to see that. What is the answer to the gang wars? What is the answer to the drug trafficking? What is the answer to runaway government spending? What is the answer to terrorism? We are facing social issues for which, at the present time, we have no answers. We have no answers for the high divorce rate. We have no answers for the family breakdown. There's a whole social order that is breaking down around us, and we have no answers for it. Distress of nations with perplexity. We're perplexed as to know what to do to solve the problems that we have today in our society. And as a result, men's hearts failing them for the fear of the things that are coming upon the earth and of these cataclysmic events. But when these things happen, Jesus said, immediately after those days, they're going to see the sign of the Son of Man coming with clouds and great glory. I don't want to discourage or disappoint you, but I think that the clouds here may not refer to the physical clouds that we see in the sky. I think that it could refer to the church that will be returning with Jesus Christ when he comes again. In Hebrews chapter 11, we have a listing of the hall of faith, the men of the Old Testament who made the hall of faith. How these men, through faith, did such tremendous exploits. And then having listed these men and the things that they had done, in chapter 12 it begins, seeing then that we are surrounded or encompassed with such a great cloud of witnesses. So the cloud there refers to all of these faithful saints. And I believe that he's coming in the clouds could refer to coming with the saints, because we know that Paul said, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall we also appear with him in glory. Jude said, behold, he cometh with 10,000s of his saints. Revelation chapter 17 speaks about him coming on a white horse and the armies that came with him. So, as I said, when you go out and you see one of those beautiful cloudy days and clouds are beautiful, think, oh, maybe this is the day. Well, yes, it could be the day, but it may not be referring to coming in the clouds, the physical clouds that you see. But always look up, no matter what. It's good. And of course, Southern California, we have a lot of days to see the clouds, in the morning at least. And so, reminder that the Lord is coming. But Jesus said that we are to pray then for two things. Watch ye therefore and pray always. He's talking to his disciples now. Thus, he's talking to us. And we're to pray for two things. First of all, we're to pray that we will be accounted worthy to escape these things that are going to come to pass. Now, he's been talking to us about the things of the great tribulation, when the wrath of God is poured out against the sinners, against the wicked. He's saying, pray that you'll be accounted worthy to escape these things, the events of the great tribulation. I would suggest that when you get home, you read the first chapter of the book of Romans, beginning with verse 18, as Paul speaks to us concerning the wrath of God that is going to be revealed from heaven against the godliness and the unrighteousness of men who hold the truth of God in unrighteousness. For when they knew God, Paul said, they didn't glorify him as God. Neither were they thankful. But their foolish hearts were darkened. And professing themselves to be wise, they became fools as they began to worship and serve the creature more than the Creator. That is, they became tree huggers, and they were putting more emphasis upon animals than God or man. And we see this today, as there is a tremendous move towards the worship of Mother Earth. It's being taught in our schools. Our children from early grades are being taught, really, to worship Mother Earth, the creative forces of the earth, to respect, to love. And they're not taught that to do that to God, but to the creature rather than the Creator. And it's because, Paul said, they didn't want to retain God in their minds. And thus God gave them over to reprobate minds. And as he describes there in chapter 1, the effects of people who want to rule God out, who want nothing to do with God, who want to eliminate God. And again, you have it in evolution, the worship of the creature rather than the creator. These people who want to get God out of the way, out of their minds, out of their lives, it creates a total social disaster that Paul describes in the remaining of Romans chapter 1. And I suggest that you read that over. Tonight we'll go into that some, but we don't have time this morning. But it's social chaos when you get God off of the scene. And so God's wrath is going to be poured out upon the earth during a period of tremendous social chaos, social disorder. That's the first thing you're to pray for, that you won't be around when that happens. When the judgment of God begins to fall upon this earth, that you won't be here. The second thing you're to pray for is that you might be standing before the Son of Man. Now in Revelation chapter 4, John tells us that after the things of the church, chapters 2 and 3, he saw a door open in heaven, and the first voice sounded like a trumpet. It said, come up hither, and I'm going to show you things that are going to be after the church things. John said, I was caught up by the Spirit into heaven. I saw the throne of God, the glory of the throne, and I saw the cherubim about the throne as they were worshiping God. I heard the elders that were there responding to their worship and declaring the worthiness of God to receive that worship. And then he said, I saw a scroll in the right hand of him who was sitting on the throne, and it was sealed with seven seals. I heard an angel say, who's worthy to take that scroll, which is the title deed of the earth, and to loose the seals? And John said, there wasn't any man who was found worthy. No man can save the world. No man can save himself. No man can redeem the world. No man was found worthy to take the scroll or to loose the seals. And John said, I began to sob convulsively. But one of the elders tapped me on the shoulder and said, hey, don't cry, John. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, he's made it. He's going to take the scroll and loose the seals. And John said, I turned and I saw him. He looked like a lamb that had been slain, but he came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat upon the throne. And when he did, they offered to the Lord the prayers of the saints, and they sang a new song saying, worthy is the Lamb to take the scroll and to loose the seals, for he was slain, but he's redeemed us by his blood out of all of the families and tongues and nations of the world, and he's made us unto our God kings and priests, and we're going to reign with him on the earth. Look at the lyrics of that song. Worthy is the Lamb, he was slain, he has redeemed us by his blood out of all of the nations, tongues, peoples, tribes, and so forth. Who can sing that? Only the church. And so as he takes the scroll and he begins to loose the seals, there are the corresponding judgments of the great tribulation. And as we read the sixth seal, they were hiding in the rocks and they were fainting and they were saying, fall on us, hide us from the face of the Lamb, for the day of his wrath has come. Who shall be able to stand? So Jesus is saying, you pray two things. One, that you won't be here, but that you will be there. That you'll be standing before the Son of Man. And know this, you're going to be one of two places. So you should pray always that you'll be accounted worthy to escape these things. You say, well, how can I be worthy? By receiving Jesus Christ and receiving the forgiveness of your sins. The Bible tells us that if we will confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God calls upon us to turn from that path of sin, turn from a life governed by our fleshly desires, and live a life that is governed by the Spirit of God. Look what living after the flesh has gained for you. Look at all the misery and sorrow and turmoil that it's brought to you. It's time to wake up and realize that living after the flesh is death, but living after the Spirit is life and peace and joy. The day is coming. I do not believe it is far removed. I think that what we see today is a precursor of these things. I think we're seeing the beginning of sorrows. I think that we're seeing events that are going to lead us right into the period of the Great Tribulation. And when it starts, you don't want to be here. But also, when it starts, it's too late to pray that you might escape it. Now's the time for salvation. Now is the time to be ready. Jesus said, "Blessed are those servants who, when the Lord comes, he will find them watching." Question is, where are you now? Because the chances are where you are now is where you will be then. Unless radical changes are made. And the time for changes is now. If you have not yet received Jesus Christ, if you're still a part of this whole world system in rebellion against God, you better get on the boat. He's about ready to pull up the gangplank and we're about ready to sail. You better get on board now. Pray always you'll be accounted worthy to escape these things that are going to come to pass and that you might stand before the Son of Man. You better believe that's my prayer. And I have that trust and confidence that through Jesus Christ, I have not been appointed to wrath, but I'm a child of God and will be standing in that glorious company in heaven, singing the worthiness of the Lamb to take the scroll and to break the seals. Shall we pray? Lord, we do ask that you would guide us by your Holy Spirit into that place of acceptance. We thank you, Lord, that through Jesus Christ, our sins have been forgiven, and that his righteousness has been accounted to our account because of our faith in him. Lord, our hope is built on nothing less than the blood of Jesus and his righteousness. Lord, we're trusting in you. Trusting in you fully, Lord. We know that we can't save ourselves. We're trusting you, Lord, to deliver us from the wrath to come. And so, Lord, I pray for those here today who have not yet made that commitment to Jesus Christ, who have not yet surrendered themselves, but still are at war with you and against righteousness. Lord, let them put down their weapons. Let them surrender. Let them experience and know your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we stand? Jesus did warn in context, verse 34, take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life, so that that day will catch you unprepared. Watch out. We're living in a world that has a tremendous emphasis on worldly things. Be careful that you're not so involved that you be caught unaware or unprepared for the day of the Lord. For as a snare, Jesus said, it shall come upon all of those that dwell upon the face of the whole earth. So watch, therefore, be watching, be praying always. Today, I don't know where you stand. Only you and God know that. You know what your relationship with God is. You know where your heart is. But I do know that Jesus loves you and he doesn't want you to perish. God hasn't appointed us to wrath. He's appointed that we should be his children. He invites you to come. He said, let's reason together. Though your sins are as scarlet, they can be as white as snow. You can be washed today. You can be forgiven your sins. Just come. I would encourage you, go back to the prayer room. Get right with God. The day of the Lord, I believe, is at hand. I'm convinced of that. And I'm praying, Lord, put me with the number that are standing there with you in heaven when this whole thing breaks out. May the Lord quicken our hearts. And may we be obedient. May all of us be watching and praying always, as we are aware that the time of the Lord's coming is at hand. The Lord bless thee,
God bless thee.
And keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make
his face.
Now, on behalf of the Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact the Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.